Good evening.
And welcome to the all candidates meeting. I've got a four-page introduction thing here that somebody left at my home. I'll cut it down to 2 minutes. I'd like to welcome everybody here this evening, our mayor, Barbara John, and our candidates. And I am really pleased this evening to see so many of you out. A couple of points. One, you all know where the washrooms are if you need them. They're out in the lobby, in that area. Fire exits in case of emergency, back of the room, and on either side down at the front of the room. I'd like to thank our sponsors for putting this on, the municipality, our candidates, and also some well-deserved members of our Chamber of Commerce, Cedric Steele and his associates, Innovative Community Solutions, and the Saxe Point Daycare for sponsoring us. A special thanks to our team, the Esquimalt Residents Association, which have done a tremendous job in putting this this meeting together. Also, the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce, and let's not forget our volunteer students from Esquimalt High, for organization of what's happening here, including my microphone. And now, so we can get the show on the road, I would like to introduce our moderator, Dave Dixon, who is from, he is host of the Straight Talk, which is on daily from 1 to 2 at CFAX 1070. We would also like to thank Dave as well for, as other in the media, for their coverage of our Esquimalt municipal election. Please join me in welcoming Dave Dixon tonight. He's hiding behind the curtain.
Thanks, Dino. Hot mic. Right, thanks, sir, for hosting. First of all, thanks to the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce and the Esquimalt Residents Association, of course, Esquimalt High, for putting on tonight's one and only all candidates meeting. These are interesting times for Esquimalt, looking back and looking forward. Considering Esquimalt's past 100 years and getting ready for the next 100, Esquimalt can be well situated to benefit, of course, from the big announcement last month, the $8 billion shipyard program. Also, the community is faced with challenges as well as opportunities. The Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce and Esquimalt Residents Association would like to welcome you to this all candidates meeting. The community was canvassed for questions for this all candidates meeting. And based on this input, the working committee prepared the list of questions for tonight's event. The candidates, who are to my left here, were provided in advance tonight's questions along with the materials submitted by the Esquimalt community. And right now I'd like to review the predetermined rules that will result in our meeting being conducted democratically and expeditiously. There will be a 1 minute opening statement by each candidate, and the order of candidates have been selected by a random draw. And once we introduce the candidates and after they've done their 1 minute introduction, please hold all applause until all eight candidates have been introduced. Following the 1 minute prepared statements, I will ask a series of these predetermined questions, and the order of candidates has been determined at random, as I mentioned. Each candidate will have up to 1.5 minutes to answer each question, and our timekeeper sitting in the middle will hold up a yellow card signifying you have 15 seconds before your time is up, and a red card showing that your time is complete. And right now, I'd like to begin by introducing our candidates for their 1 minute intro. To my left, and to your right, we're going from my left all the way down to the end, we have Dave Schinbein, Dave Hodgins, Tim Morrison, Sandra Dixon, Bob Mackay, Linda Hundleby, Josh Steffler, and Megan Brain. But before we get into those opening remarks, I'd like to introduce Mayor Barb Desjardins with some opening statements.
Thank you. I apologize. I have a piece of paper because I only have 2 minutes too. I'm feeling a little left out, but not so much. So good luck to everyone. First of all, I'd like to express my heartfelt thanks to Esquimalt for the confidence that you have given me in the mandate to continue as your mayor for the second term. I look forward to working with your council that you elect on November 19th. Esquimalt is now and will continue to be the place where people look to live, work, and play. This has been apparent over the last 3 years with Esquimalt experiencing modest growth and development, even through some pretty difficult financial times. The recent announcement of the $8 billion, 30 million, or 30-year shipbuilding contract, of which it is estimated 800 jobs and $30 million worth of infrastructure will go into the dockyard, means that Esquimalt will be well poised to take advantage. We, as your elected officials, must be ready to take advantage of it, to capture for Esquimalt some of those secondary benefits. We've already got the primary benefit: housing, connecting new businesses, and our service sector provisioning, and even improving our public transit. I want to thank these people up here on this stage for putting their names forward in service of Esquimalt. And I look forward to hearing from them their thoughts and ideas as to how to keep Esquimalt sustainable and prosperous. Thank you.
Thank you, Barb. All right, let's get into those opening statements, and we're going to go in that order, that random draw. First up, to my immediate left, is Dave Schinbein.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. A municipal councillor's main responsibility is to you, the taxpayers, to ensure that your money is spent in a prudent manner. That being said, I believe that a municipal councillor's role is to be open-minded to all requests for funding that come before council. Further, I believe the councillor must weigh the pros and cons of each request and take into account the greater good of all citizens. Throughout the term of council, many groups will come forward with many ideas, complaints, concerns, and sometimes outright anger. As a councillor, I believe in hearing each group out and assisting each group, providing it is fiscally responsible to do so. What are some of the concerns that face Esquimalt? Of course, fiscal responsibility is always there. Development issues, transportation, sewage treatment is another big one. And of course, taking advantage of the new shipbuilding contract. Previously I have served as a municipal councillor in Ontario, as a town and a county councillor. And I hope to bring that experience to Esquimalt and serve you, the residents of Esquimalt.
Dave Hodgins.
Thank you, David. And thank you to the organizers, and kudos to you for being here and for being involved. It really is about you, and it is about Esquimalt at the end of the day, and I understand that. It's my hope that you will see my considerable experience at a municipal level, considerable experience in administration and as a volunteer at the same time. And I'm hoping that you'll see that experience as something positive to bring to the table in terms of supporting Esquimalt Council. One thing experience has taught me, that to be successful requires open, honest, two-way communications. And my commitment to you is to bring my record of openness and transparency to the council table and to the citizens and businesses of Esquimalt. We're facing a number of significant challenges, affordability certainly being one of them. To address these challenges will require a council that is committed to working together and working hard in the best interest of all of us who live and enjoy Esquimalt. Thank you.
Tim Morrison.
Does this mic come out at all? Is that possible? No, I just wonder if I...
Here.
Thank you very much. I spend all day sitting behind a desk, so I really wanted to stand up tonight. I think it is important that all of us candidates do stand up and tell you the reason why we are running. The reason I am running is that I have been involved in this community for quite some time now as co-chair of the Esquimalt Residents Association and as editor of the EsquimaltReview.com. And it's so great to see so many familiar faces here tonight, people that I have been able to have the fortune of interacting with and meeting and being engaged with over the last couple of years. The reason why I became co-chair of the Esquimalt Residents Association and the reason why I founded EsquimaltReview.com is the same reason why I'm running as a candidate tonight. And that's because it's something that all of us in this room have in common. We've all been there. We've all had the same conversation. Sometimes it's awkward, sometimes it's humorous. But whether it's at work or at social engagements, the question always comes up, where do you live? And I always very proudly say, I live in Esquimalt. And then you wait for it. There's that weird kind of puzzled look. Why do you live in Esquimalt? And I'm so happy to answer that question because I can say all the wonderful things about Esquimalt. But that's not the focus tonight. Tonight is to talk about the problems in Esquimalt. Policing, open government, property taxation. Those are all the top, sewage treatment. And that's what we'll be talking about more. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tim. Sandra Dixon.
Hi. My name is Sandra Dixon, and I've been living in Esquimalt for 41 years. When I was 25, I moved out and started a family, got married, and 15 years ago, we had an opportunity to move back to Esquimalt. And the reasons were, as my father said, everything we needed was here. And I would like to continue living here the way I have been. I've been enjoying being back in Esquimalt. I used to live in Saanich, and the Saanich got bigger, and I just thought, let's go home. This is my home. The people, when I was growing up, people used to help my family, and they're still on my street, and we still help each other, and I'm hoping to do my best if I get voted in. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
Thank you. My name is Bob McKay. I have lived in Esquimalt for 44 years. I'm retired in 2009. I have sat on many organizations, sports organizations, different youth groups in Esquimalt. I have been the co-chairman of Buccaneer Days for the last 5 years. I have sat on the Access and Awareness and the Parks and Rec Advisory Committee for the last 3 years. I've enjoyed sitting on these committees to help make Esquimalt more enjoyable for the people to live in our area. We have to listen to the people of Esquimalt, be open to the response of the citizens of Esquimalt to show that we are the leaders. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
Good evening. Thank you for attending this all candidates meeting. I'm really glad to see you here. I'm Linda Hundleby. As a three-term councillor, the last two plus one previously, with a background of government skill sets and an abiding commitment to Esquimalt, demonstrated by my significant history of community involvement going back almost 30 years, I offer my keen interest and willingness to serve for the next term. I'm very concerned about our rising property taxes and at the same time wonder how we will be able to sustain the quality of life that we treasure in Esquimalt. We need a long-term vision that belongs to the whole community in order for the council to plan and develop a sustainable future. All of us need to work on this together for it to be successful. I commit to building relationships and continuing to work hard on your behalf. Thank you for your consideration.
Josh Steffler.
Good evening. My name is Josh Steffler and I'm totally new to this. I don't really have any experience in municipal council. I'm a baker. You might recognize me or remember me from the Fight HST campaign, which I was the riding captain for last year. Because of the Fight HST campaign, I saw how well referendum and direct democracy could work. And in Esquimalt, I saw decisions made behind closed doors and many decisions that were made when talking to residents. Many of us felt like we were not asked what council should do, but rather told what we will do by council. I am concerned because I see this happening again with LRT, with the sewage treatment, and again, I believe that we're being told what to do and not asked what to do. I am worried about rising costs, rising taxes. As a small family, I know that I personally can't afford much more tax increases, and I think many of you feel the same way. Thank you.
Megan Brame.
I'd like to start off by thanking the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce and Residents Association for hosting this event this evening, and I'd like to thank you all for taking the time to come out and be a part of it. My name is Megan Brame, and I'm running for re-election to Esquimalt Council because I'm committed to our community. I believe that Esquimalt truly is the greatest place to live in the Greater Victoria area, and I want to continue doing my part to keep it that way. I have been involved in Esquimalt for more than two decades. I own and operate a licensed group childcare facility in the community, and my husband Steve and I have raised our two sons here. I am also a member of the community and business groups in Esquimalt, both in my capacity as councillor, as business owner, and as a resident. My first term on council has been an exciting and interesting experience, and I am feeling more confident going forward into the next 3 years because of the knowledge and insights I've gained from the past term. My proudest accomplishment in my last term was the youth engagement policy. It allowed youth to have a voice on committees and to be heard. Through my home, business, and recreational activities, I truly follow Esquimalt's motto of live, work, and play in Esquimalt.
Thank you, candidates. Now let's get to the questions. I will start the first question. We're going to start with Dave Schinbein. Second question will be Dave Hodgins. Third question, Tim Morrison, all the way down the line until all nine, or all eight candidates, rather, have had a chance to answer these questions. So question number one. There is significant development going on in many areas of Greater Victoria. Of course, there's the $8 billion project that could benefit Esquimalt. Esquimalt appears to be at a crossroads regarding its image and how much development it is willing to take on. Some people want change, while others are very happy with status quo. Some people want more swallows landing type developments and more business. Others want more low-cost housing. What is your vision for the future image of Esquimalt?
Thank you. I believe that we need to have a balanced approach to development. And I believe that a municipality needs to have an identity and needs to have a unique identity. And I believe that the identity that I see for Esquimalt is a combination of development and a combination of maintaining the small town feel that Esquimalt has, which was one of the big attractions that I had for moving here. I also would like to encourage for developing our vision that everybody participates in answering the referendum question, because obviously that is going to give us some direction as a council, assuming I'm there, as a council, to know what direction that the majority of the people would like to take. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
My vision is really based on your vision, what you've been telling me as I've been out and about talking to people, door knocking, listening, and attending events. And that's one great thing about our community of Esquimalt. People aren't shy about sharing what they believe could and should be, and with a lot of passion at the same time. And really, that's what it is for me. It's about a vision that's achievable through the passion of the individuals involved at the table making the decisions, and that passion being based on what we're being told by the youth and the individuals, the families, and the businesses of Esquimalt. I hear that we need affordable and sustainable services. We need development, but it needs to be the right kind of development. It needs to be respectful development. I mean, we're not able to develop our way to a financial future, but development is certainly part of that. We need to look at innovation and how we're doing businesses and how we can do business differently through integration and reaching out into the neighboring communities and looking to support one another. You know, it really is about creating those core services, public safety services and recreation services, services for individuals and families, and building from there. I'll talk more about this when I have another chance.
Thank you. Tim Morrison?
Sure. I kind of started off this campaign somewhat concerned or even fearing that we'd be a divided community on this question. And really, I haven't experienced that at all. Like Dave, I've been out door knocking and talking to voters, and what I hear is a call for balance. People want that small town appeal of Esquimalt. That's why they moved here. They want that preserved, but they know that it's going to come at a cost, because otherwise our property taxes are going to continue to rise year after year. You talk to long-term residents, I'll talk a little more about this on taxes later, their taxes have been going up for a long, long time, and that's the pattern that happens in Esquimalt. But we want that small town where your kids are playing hockey on the front street, you can speak over the fence in your backyard to your neighbors. If we want to preserve all that, we need to have that balance, and everyone gets that. So we need to respect the official community plan that allows for our small town appeal lifestyle to be somewhat subsidized by some density development in key areas. For example, at the old Esquimalt Inn, that you've all heard the news today that council approved last night, that there will be a tower put there. That's an appropriate place for it. It's away from the more traditional neighborhoods, the small town style neighborhoods of Esquimalt, that we will be able to preserve through that influx of revenue to help balance our property tax increases and perhaps reduce our property taxes. Thank you.
Sandra Dixon.
Hi. I like it to stay the way it was when I was a child. People cared, and they had lots of things to do. I basically want it to stay the same, not like Swallow's Landing. There are no swallows in Swallow's Landing anymore. Yes, we need small businesses, more restaurants, and maybe a second-run theater. I know I don't want to see big buildings and more traffic. I like to walk along the waterside. I like to walk where there's no traffic and noise. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
My vision for the future image of Esquimalt is a healthy, vibrant, growing community. One problem is we have little space for expansion. We're a bedroom community, so we need to have a good look at how we grow. We need to listen to the citizens of Esquimalt. Most of us have lived here all of our lives. We know what we want. So the only way that we can achieve this is if we listen to the people of Esquimalt and we take that to council, and hopefully council will listen to the people instead of the developers, to ensure we are developing what is in Esquimalt's best knowledge, and to see our future, we need to keep on top of everything. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
My vision for the future image of Esquimalt. I want it to be more than a bedroom community of Victoria. I see a community of caring intergenerational families and individuals living in a safe, clean, and well-maintained walkable community, which might mean a need for heightened density and maybe a reduced need for cars. Local shopping for basic needs, also known as community retail, groceries, banks, pharmacy, hardware store, maybe more. I want amenities and shops for recreation, health, fitness, culture, and community building. We need destination restaurants. We want a public waterfront walkways and access points, well-maintained parks and green spaces, and we need a community working together to make it happen. I'm looking for a healthy, sustainable community, not an amalgamated one. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
My vision for Esquimalt is for our future to have no longer have this 3 p.m. traffic jam where nobody can get in or out of Esquimalt. I believe that it is government's job to facilitate the growth and decisions that the citizens desire. My vision would be an Esquimalt that believes strongly in property rights and helps citizens enjoy and enforce their own property rights. I don't think that Esquimalt is one giant homogenous neighborhood. We are many neighborhoods that all have their own different feel, and as a council, we should help each neighborhood with the developments that they and the growth that they see fit, rather than tell everybody what you're going to do in this neighborhood or you're going to do in that neighborhood. I would like to see some higher density growth in the right places. I know that there are people concerned about the Village project, and I think that we need to have a lot more discussion about this, because if we just put a giant 12-story building there, we will be infringing on some people's property rights, and I don't think that's right. I think that we should be making sure everybody has their fair say.
Megan Brame.
I see Esquimalt being a place that people of all walks of life live in. People who are just starting out, families, and retirees. We are, and should be, a place where people never want to leave. I see us having more business in our community, and one of the main ways to attract business is to keep our taxes at reasonable levels. We cannot, however, keep business taxes down at the expense of the residents, but we need to keep them down as a whole overall. I want to keep and maintain our recreation and green space. It's a main way for our community to stay connected and healthy. There are areas in our OCP where our municipality, it shows, can utilize height and density, and a great way to use mixed development. We will add people, business, and a stronger economic basis for our community. We need density to keep our taxes down and maintain the services and businesses we currently have and love. I want us to be a diverse community, a community open to change and growth. I want us to keep moving forward.
Thanks to all candidates for keeping on time as well. Let's move on to question number two, and after I'll ask the question, we'll start with Dave Hodgins. Many municipalities have been discussing amalgamation, integration, and potential consolidation to one city. Topics include the role of the CRD, shared finance and administration, more common services, overlapping costs of so many individual municipalities. What opportunities do you see for Esquimalt regarding how services are provided? Dave Hodgins.
There are many very positive opportunities with respect to how we're currently doing business and how we can better do business. And I've certainly heard and had a lot of good ideas shared with me from people, again, that I've connected with in Esquimalt. And I do hear it's not about the A word. It's not all about amalgamation. I mean, we have to be very careful that we maintain a presence within our community and the ability through policy to ensure that we are respectful of what's happening within our various neighborhoods. But I'll tell you, it is about integration, and people are talking a lot about how do we better integrate? How do we better connect across the system and within the system to provide for more shared services and look for economy of scale while actually increasing the level of service while reducing resources overall so that we are affordable and long term. And I hear from people that you want to be involved in the decision-making process much, much more than you are now. And we can do that through various social networking and webcasting and making sure that information is widely available before, during, and after. You know, I remember working in a municipality where we had an idea on the table and the lawyers said, no, you can't do that. We did it. You will not hear me say we cannot do that. We need to find a way to do that. Thank you.
Tim Morrison.
I think on this question, we need to get away from this sort of phenomenon of keeping up with the Joneses. Like one municipality has this, then we have to have it as well. We have to match it. And what's been going on for this last several decades is basically keeping up with the Joneses, where each municipality is trying to outdo the other in terms of who has more things, who has a bigger empire in this regional district of 13 fiefdoms, I guess you could call it. But you know, we're only 17,000 people, and we're surrounded by municipalities who are also, some of them, a lot smaller than ours. Some of them are bigger than ours. Why not all of us get together, integrate, get away from the segregation, save a lot of tax dollars by, you know, we're all duplicating the exact same functions. Why not centralize some of those administrative functions? One area that we could have shared services very successfully is on policing. And that's become more apparent than ever before. We don't want to move to, I think a lot of you are here tonight because you're concerned about this talk that we're moving to RCMP. That's not the direction to go. The direction is to go more together as one united regional shared police force. They're just going to save us a lot of tax dollars, especially for Esquimalt residents, and it'll actually create more effective policing across the region to fight crime. Thank you.
Sandra Dixon.
To me, that's a tough question. I've been in bed and sitting up worrying what I was going to say all this time. When I was a little girl, I knew there was more than one police station, and I always thought they helped out each other. I can't see why all municipalities and fire departments can't help each other. One thing that can be done to get the bar owners to help out in the cost and pay for the police, because downtown is, that's where the problem is. And if there's drug money found, use that too. Maybe the municipalities could be bigger, but I still believe communities should have their own fire and police departments 24 hours a day for safety reasons. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
I can see that in the future we will have to share major services in Greater Victoria as the costs keep rising. And if we don't share these services, our taxes are going to go skyrocketing. We have a small community. We need to look at how we can get the best quality of service for everybody so that we are safe, our jobs are done correctly at the best dollar. And I think the only way that we can do that is to get into talks, to let's get our services joined together. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
I think we need to seek efficiencies, whether they be amalgamated, integrated, contracted, shared between two, or solely provided by frontline township staff. There are already contracts between View Royal and the township, and an existing one with Victoria. We need a business case to justify changes and that they demonstrate similar or improvements in cost, quality of service, and be accountable. The township is best served where there is quality service delivery, accountability, flexibility, and control of costs. Contracts would need to be negotiated so that arrangements are a win-win for everyone. Relationship building between municipalities is an absolute priority. No municipality should be taken advantage of, and any impacts to staff should be minimized and considered within the collective agreement. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
I myself am opposed to amalgamation. I see that the more we centralize the power and the services, the farther and farther it gets away from communities. I think that we can collaborate with other municipalities to share services, and they can be win-win where both municipalities prosper and profit through proper contracts where we still maintain the control over Esquimalt's tax dollars. The more we amalgamate and push towards a CRD controlled systems and have the CRD provide us these services, the less and less control we will have over the cost increases and the quality of service. So we could have contracts, we can collaborate, but I don't want to amalgamate. There's an old saying that good fences make good neighbors, and I like Saanich and View Royal as neighbors. I don't want them to be my roommates, though. Thanks.
Megan Brame.
I'm sure that there are some services that could be amalgamated, but the current CRD model of amalgamation for some of our services offers Esquimalt little choice or say in the decisions brought forward. Look at sewage treatment for a recent example. Rushing into any amalgamation without clear governance structure and financing schedule could be more destructive to our community than the current situation. Would our streets, parks, homes get the attention that our residents want and need? How would it affect the great services that we have in our community? Would it spread them too thin? To integrate or amalgamate services, there would need to be a serious review of the business case for it, making sure that it is in the best interest of our community, both financially and socially. I do, however, believe that amalgamation could work for policing, if done correctly, including every municipality in the CRD, and with a strong governance structure that allowed for community input and that was sustainable. We do have many borders in this region, and crime knows that. By having an amalgamated police force, we could get tougher on crime and show a strong force.
Dave Schinbein.
Thank you. I believe that shared services is probably the way to go to the future. And the multitude of services that could be shared is pretty much endless. It isn't just police, fire, the big ticket items. It's right down to standardized building codes. It's down to things like a garbage pickup and things like that. And I know from previous experience as a counselor that the jurisdiction I was in, we were faced with that dilemma. And we did get together and share a lot of services. The key, I think, is what's been mentioned already, is that it's done in an economical way. That it's done that Esquimalt pays their fair share, but yet still has the ability to make comments and to be able to vote and have a more equal say in what goes on. And I think that is the key that we need to be looking at. We could debate from now till the cows come home about which services we should do that with. But I believe that we need to get together with our neighbors, talk about the services that we can share, and then work towards getting those services. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. Question number three. There are always ways to improve the effectiveness of processes for providing input and requesting services from the municipality, and on how to improve communication between municipality and council with residents and businesses. This can help with requests such as repairs to sidewalks and streets, signage, lighting, deer, squirrels, changes to zoning and development processes. What can be done to improve the effectiveness of the process and communications with the residents and businesses of Esquimalt? We'll start with Tim Morrison.
I'm really, really happy this was my question to start with, because this is actually one of my main reasons for running. This is my if I could accomplish anything over this next term if I'm elected, it would be to open up the doors on Municipal Hall. Let me show you something here. Do you see what that is? You don't see anything. It's a blank piece of paper. That's exactly what we know about the future policing for Esquimalt, a blank piece of paper. That's not open government, all right? All we know is that a contract has been awarded to RCMP. We don't know how much it's going to cost, how much our tax dollars are going to be affected, how much our services are going to be affected. We don't know where they're going to be located. We don't know any of those things. We want to probably discuss all of that tonight. This is an appropriate venue to be doing that. It's a top issue, yet we have nothing to talk about because the issue is being kept closed to the public. That's not acceptable. That's one example of where we can open up. Bring the decision-making process into the community before the decision is made, not after the decision. We saw that movie with the HSD, and we know how that ends. It doesn't end well. The other example I'll give you is something very practical and very easy to do that could be done the first day that we're elected to council, is to post the full, complete, public agenda packages that council looks at every week on the website. Right now, we're the only municipality amongst many municipalities across the province that doesn't really do that. That's not right. Another issue is social media. We need to get on social media, connect with younger demographics, engage more people in this community as to what the council is up to.
Thanks, Tim.
Yeah, thank you.
We're out
much.
Of time. Okay. Sandra Dixon.
Best on this one. One is listen to the long-term residents. Help them out. Give them ideas on how to solve their problem they are having. Don't pass the problem on to somebody else without telling the person with the problem. We had a problem. Our family had a problem, and I went to City Hall to see what I could do, and they said, we'll look into it. We didn't get a phone call back. We went to the police. We told them. We didn't get a phone call back. We ended up doing something what we shouldn't have done. We dealt with it ourselves. And that was with the drug addicts we had living behind our house. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
Thank you. As a longtime resident of Esquimalt, I have talked to a lot of people, and I've heard from a lot of people say, well, when we talk, nobody listens. So I think what needs to happen is there needs to be more open talks with the citizens of Esquimalt to allow them to have their input into the different things that are going on in our community. The effect of all this is, let's do the job right. Let's do it right the first time, and not let's correct it after we've already done it. A lot of times we have done things in Esquimalt, and after the job is complete, somebody's come forward and said, well, how come we have not done this? Oh, sorry, we forgot about that. Or, oh, that wasn't brought up. That is things that we need to change. And just for instance, let's look at Craig Flower Road. Totem poles, telephone poles, whatever you want to call them, could have been put in at the start. Now it's going to cost us money to have those things put in. Services could have been put underground, but no, we didn't do it. And I think that's things that could have been brought forward by the people of Esquimalt. They probably were, but they were not listened to. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
First, I would say that we need to understand that under the community charter, all discussions and all decisions are to be made in public, with exceptions permitted under Section 90. Generally, those are legal, property, personnel, or business, which follows the Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. I'd really like to see more residents encouraged to attend council meetings and to take advantage of public input opportunities, and I personally invite all of you to come. I'd like to see some town hall meetings to augment council meetings, and agenda packages could be made available on the website. If financially feasible, council should consider video access if residents would find that useful. Under communications, in addition to the mayor's open door opportunities, I'd like to see more forums focusing on specific topics as in the past, for example, taxation and policing objectives. And I'd like to see a better correspondence flow. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
So I would like to see more referendums and more use of technology. We are moving forward and we have so much access to internet, social networks, Skype. Almost every resident now has the means to access any counselors, and I guess not many people are feeling like they're being listened to. I don't believe any decisions by Esquimalt Council should be made behind closed doors, regardless of the Freedom of Information Act or not. We work for you, and so we shouldn't be allowed to hide anything from any resident in Esquimalt. I may not understand the Privacy Act or the Freedom of Information Act, but I do understand that council works for the residents, and you don't get to have your employees tell the boss, oh, well, you don't get to know that. Sorry, we're not telling you. I think binding referendums would work. They may not work for everything, and I don't think that we should be governing by referendum, but we need more direct democracy rather than representative democracy. Council decisions should not be made by seven people. They should be made by 17,000. Thank you.
Megan Brame.
I have worked hard over the past 3 years to make a lot of connections between the business community and Esquimalt Council. As a business owner myself, I know how important it is to have that connection. I have regularly attended the executive meetings of the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce as the council liaison, relaying information to council from the chamber and from the chamber to council to keep that connection strong. I feel that we do indeed need to revisit our online agenda policy to make it more accessible to the general public. Recently, at the Union of British Columbia Municipalities Conference, I attended several different meetings and workshops in regards to open and transparent government, and I look forward to us being able to implement some of those things that I found at that workshop. One thing I have learned from my first term is that the more things are in the open, the clearer things are for the residents, and when there is open communication, the residents trust your decisions much more. I have tried to be a very responsive counselor, and I feel that part of the role of being a counselor is to be the liaison between residents and staff, somebody that they feel that they can and do talk to.
Dave Schinbein.
You know, given today's technology, I would advocate for an internet service request form that could be used by any business or residents if they notice any issues that require attention. The business or resident would input that over the internet, and they would receive like a work order or a response number, and that would suddenly give the resident a method to follow up on whatever requests that they might have. And again, that gives to more open government. It allows the resident to say, here's the issue, have a follow-up system to it. I'm in full agreement that there is, given again today's technology, there's no reason why the package that is given to a counselor cannot be put on the internet. I do understand that there are certain things under the community charter that of course must be dealt with in camera. And I would strongly work towards seeing that this system of being able to access the community or access the municipality, state your concern, get a number or a code or something assigned to that so that follow-up can be done. Thank you very much.
Dave Hodgins.
To truly engage people, I think we need to get beyond the words and get to some action. And when we talk about open, honest communications, there are some great processes to allow for that. There's some great technology today to allow for people to be better engaged. I mean, I agree. A great example of how not to do it, how to really disengage people, is what's happening to us in the area of police services. You know, we started asking a month ago for their information so we could be informed candidates and talk intelligently with you about where we're going on police services. And to date, all we have is the fact that we have RCMP. There's still so many more questions that we're being asked, and we don't have the answers. So that's not the way you engage people, you know. And you talk about how to better reach out and connect. And the youth in our community, I think we pay a little bit of lip service at times. We're not doing a good job of connecting with our youth. Kudos to the youth that are here this evening, and great that we're in the high school. We need to do a lot more to better connect the youth so that they're engaged in the future going forward. For me, it's about a process referred to, and well-defined process, citizen-centered services. And think about that one and how we better connect and engage individuals. We talk about police. We were meeting with some people last night. Have you heard about Denniston Park? There was an opportunity to engage people before the boulders were dumped on them, and yet it didn't happen. So there's a lot of work to do, but I know that there's a lot of keen interest in making positive change, and that's certainly what I will bring to the table if elected.
Thanks, Dave. Next question, number four. Esquimalt's taxes continue to go up, while some other municipalities have had their taxes go down. There are concerns related to the Esquimalt Community Plan, annual budget, municipal staffing levels, administration, and operations, as well as commercial and residential development. What do you feel should be done to control and potentially lower our Esquimalt taxes? And we'll start with Sandra Dixon.
When the developer comes in, they should pay a percentage on each unit long term to help out the costs of sewers, streets, and sidewalks, etc. They are the ones making the big dollars, not the taxpayers. Bring in small businesses, restaurants, a secondhand theater, or maybe the bowling alley. I used to bowl. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
I feel we need to have a better handle on how our tax dollars are spent. To do this, we need more accountability from our management to ensure we are getting the most efficient services for our dollars. We also need to come up with a plan that will lure businesses to Esquimalt and stay to help them reduce our tax dollars. We need to stop these people from coming in, developers, and taking a charge over us. We need to take charge over them. And if we do that, I think our taxes will come into line. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
Staff, from my perspective, have been diligent in creating more efficiencies to our services and programs. For example, we've reduced energy needs in our rec facilities, which saves us money. And we need to do more of this. A new police provider may help us reduce our taxes for protective services, but some residents have told me that they are willing to pay more. I don't think I am. Residents need to advise us what services and programs they would like cut. There are none identified to date, as we appear to value our quality of life and all that Esquimalt can offer residents. From the last election, it is clear that the costs of the Archie Browning Sports Center were not an issue for residents. As an example, and one that I do not support, we could look at taking out all of our planted medians and replacing with pavers, which might reduce one gardener. But I don't see residents suggesting that, and I think it would look awful. Another example might be to reduce garbage pickup to once per month, but I don't think that's a great idea, as it may cause health and safety issues. And maybe the library will need to cut Sunday openings and service hours if Esquimalt Council does not see fit to provide a small increase in funding. I don't like that either. I'm certainly open to other suggestions for reducing taxes, but be prepared to cut programs and services. But as an alternative, maybe we can explore economic development options that speaks to the need to increase our tax base and enlarge our customer base. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
Taxes. Doesn't everybody love taxes? I would like to see the municipality personally live within its means. We are facing very perilous economic times in the future. Just because we don't see riots and stuff happening in Canada right now, Europe is having massive economic troubles. Canada is in debt, definitely. And during these times, households will be expected to tighten our belts. Well, should we not expect the same from City Hall? If taxes would have to rise, I would like to see them capped at the rate of inflation. And I would also like to look at Esquimalt spending and staffing and see if there are ways that we can cut our costs. Is our staffing adequate? Do we have too much? Are we paying our staff too much? Are we paying them too little? And there are ways where we can have services that people voluntarily pay for. They wouldn't exactly be taxes, but governments are supposed to offer services. And if we come up with ways to offer services that people are willing to pay for voluntarily and happily, that would be a much better way to go than just throwing another 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 5%, 6%, 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%, 11%, 12%, 13%, 14%, 15% tax increase. I was going until he gave me the red card.
Thanks.
Where do taxes stop? You
Thanks,
know?
Josh.
Thanks.
Megan Brame?
Well, there's two things in life you can depend on, death and taxes. I hear from so many that we need to keep taxes down or they will not be able to stay in our wonderful community. I want to hear from residents, and I know that the next council will as well. What do they really want and need in the way of services? Where do they want us to spend their money? Infrastructure and maintenance is important. Long-term keeping up with that will help us with keeping costs down when things break down. What else is important to them, though, besides infrastructure and maintenance? One way we can keep taxes more sustainable without sacrificing services is by bringing in a larger tax base, which means density. Our public tax forums have been working well, and I want to make sure that they continue. People have been coming out, and people have been having their say. It is important to engage the community in the budget process because we need to know where they feel we can cut back and where they feel we can spend. Budgeting is about short and long-term planning, and we need to engage the community to develop those plans to keep our taxes in check.
Dave Schinbein.
Thank you. I believe that I believe that we have to establish where our spending pattern has to be. For example, if we're taking on a new infrastructure project, whatever it might be, we know that there's going to be increases along the way. Perhaps when we develop a new infrastructure project, whatever it might be, that the minute we decide that this is the way we want to go, we need to start deciding right then and there about how much money we got to put aside to fix it, to replace it, because no matter what development we do, no matter what infrastructure we have, at some point it's going to need to be replaced or it's going to need to be repaired. I believe that to reduce the tax burden on the residents of Esquimalt, that when developers come to the community and they want to develop a particular thing, that the developer should be responsible for paying for any municipal upgrades that need to be done around that. And if that affects his profit margin a little bit, so be it. I also believe that we need to, I also believe that we need to review all the municipal contracts, and there's probably a lot of savings that could be found in just figuring out what we're paying in fees and other expenses to, for example, consultants. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
It's been said that if you don't know where you're going, any road might get you there. And it comes back to planning. It comes back to comprehensive and inclusive strategic planning and business planning towards economic development. And I, for one, am not so quick to beat up on developers. I think developers are good people. They want to be involved in the community. It's up to us, it's up to you and I and our council to find a way to best connect the developers so that it is in fact a win-win-win situation. And I know that if we get the right development at the table, our economic development, we can do a lot of good for the community of Esquimalt. It is, it's about planning, it's about solid, comprehensive planning. I'll commit to you that if elected, I will work very, very hard to ensure that taxes remain affordable, that taxes are held in line with inflation. Now, I know I would only be one member of a team working towards that, but I would bring that to the council table. It needs to be affordable, and I commit to you to work towards that affordability long term.
Tim Morrison.
Sure. Esquimalt's kind of a It's sort of a community of irony. You know, we all seek out Esquimalt. We all, young families, seniors, everybody in between, we decide to live in Esquimalt partly because it's a beautiful community and all those things, but partly because it's deemed as an affordable community. but actually we pay amongst the highest property taxes in the region and even across the province. So as I say, it's a bit of a contrast. Are we getting an affordable community or are we getting a very expensive community? What's going on? Let me tell you a story about, you might know him, a very long-term resident, Terry Prentice. He was actually on council many, many years ago. I go to these budget meetings for the last couple of years because I do want to have my voice heard as a taxpayer. And Terry happened to be there at one of this past budget session last year. And he actually did a full-on study of all his past property tax increases since he's lived here since the beginning of time. Terry is a very long-term resident. And he did the math, he did the calculation. It was 5% average every year, 5% going up every single year. That's not sustainable for an affordable community. There's been a lot of talk tonight about the community charter. One of the first, I actually worked in provincial government for quite a long time now, and one of the first projects I worked on was community charter and designing the community charter. Section 226 has a revitalization section that is an incentive for businesses to come in and invest in our community. That's how our property taxes are going to go down. We need to explore those sections of the community charter that allow for businesses to come in and to balance out our residential tax rates.
Thanks, Tim.
Thanks.
Question number 5. Squamalt has submitted a report to the Solicitor General with recommendations to move to the RCMP based on concerns of costs and services of Esquimalt policing. Esquimalt's costs per person are significantly higher than many other communities in the area. There appears to be downtown costs that are not being shared appropriately across Greater Victoria. What do you feel should be done on the policing issue and why? And we'll start with Bob Mackay.
Thank you. The policing issue is a burr in everybody's backside. The policing issue has to fall back on the provincial government. As they started the amalgamation of Esquimalt and Victoria Police, but never continued to have it completed with Saanich and Oak Bay. As soon as Esquimalt and Victoria were won, they said, okay, that's looking good, goodbye. Esquimalt, you suffer. Therefore, Esquimalt and Victoria are fighting for dollars for these services when it should be spread out throughout all of the major 4 municipalities. If we could get this done, then I think our tax dollars would come down and we would not be looking at being the second highest property owner paying taxes for our policing. We need good policing and we need to know that we are protected 24/7. And until that situation is covered, my hands are tied because the government is the final say. But if elected as a councillor, I will make sure that my voice is heard, that it should be spread throughout everybody in Greater Victoria. They all use the same services, so let's all pay for the same services. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
Council, on behalf of residents, should seek the policing agency that best reflects Esquimalt's identified needs regarding service delivery, including mutual aid and major crime, governance, how it's managed, and cost to the taxpayers. I would be interested in an integrated or amalgamated model, but none has been forthcoming, and the other municipalities have not indicated a willingness to share those costs. Given the political climate, it is clear that the current provincial government will not force amalgamation, and I have personally asked that question at one of the last conferences I attended. Having said all that, the Solicitor General is the final decision maker for the agency, and Council will have to work together with that agency to provide the best possible services to Esquimalt residences and business. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
Under the BC Police Act, every municipality is supposed to be allowed to choose their own services. Unfortunately, 7 people in Esquimalt got to choose what police service we were going to have. We're having a referendum question with the election. It would have been very easy to make the policing issue a referendum issue where we decide if we wanted Victoria Police, if we wanted RCMP, or if we wanted an Esquimalt police department. I don't buy that the Solicitor General gets to dictate to us what we're going to do in Esquimalt. We're Esquimalt. We should have our own police force if we want. We should be with Victoria Police Force if we want, or we should be with RCMP if that's what we want. But we don't know what we want because the report is blank. None of us get to see what the councillors got to see, and none of us got to make a choice. Seven people chose. Out of 17,000, that's like 0.0001%. How is that representative? You know, who are they representing? I don't know what the best service we could have got because I don't know why they chose RCMP. And I don't know what you guys would choose. I've heard people say that they want Victoria. I've heard people say that they want RCMP. And I've heard people say that they want Esquimalt police back. We should be doing what we want and not having other people dictate to us. If we can have a referendum on a zoning issue, we can have a referendum on the policing issue.
Thanks, Josh. Thank you. Megan Brame.
We need to get this issue dealt with. We want policing that is sustainable. We want a governance structure that allows for us to have a say in what we're getting. As a council, we received two packages when it came to our request for proposal. One was from Vic PD and one was from RCMP. There were no proposals sent to the panel with an option for amalgamated policing, though many of us have no issue against it. One of the proposals, or once the proposals came in, they were viewed and ranked based on the criteria in the scope of work and how close they came to what the residents actually wanted. The one that came closest was RCMP. Though neither was perfect, RCMP was closest. The final decision is not up to us, but it's up to the Solicitor General. We were only given the option of giving our opinion on which one we thought would best meet our needs based on the information given to us. The new council, I'm sure, will continue to work through this process, looking for what will best meet the needs of our community.
Dave Shinbein.
Thank you. Myself, personally, I think there should be a Plan C. And my vision of Plan C on policing would be that Esquimalt reestablishes a community police force where the patrol officers work directly for the municipality. I also believe that we should negotiate further with other municipalities to look after the other services, for example, dispatch, K-9 units, major crime units, work together on that. That could maybe be developed on a fee-for-service basis that we pay for what we use. The other big advantage to that, and I feel strongly about this, is by having a community police force like that, that allows us to have direct contact and to have direct, lost my train of thought, to have direct,
influence.
Thank you, that's why we're going to get along fine, but to have direct influence on it. And that allows Esquimalt to have their own police services board. And I think that's what I feel very strongly about. That gives us the accountability we need, gives us the police force we want, and the big ticket items, we share it throughout the whole municipality. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
Well, I'd certainly like to start by recognizing retiring Inspector Darrell McLean. I think he showed us what policing can be in Esquimalt and has done an excellent job of serving us as a representative of Victoria Police. Having said that, you know, this is a real passion for me. I've been attending police board meetings on behalf of the Esquimalt Residents Association. I was asking for the report to be released so I could be better informed and talk to you about what policing services could be. When it comes to what we do within our communities, public life safety services are really critically important. They form the foundation. We need good policing service. We need good fire services. We need good paramedic services. I did a ride along with Victoria Police and you know, they're doing great work. They are on the street. You know, there's some governance issues that we need to fix, and there's some financial considerations that we need to work on. That's absolutely true. But at the same time, when it
comes to lights and sirens, we are well served. I've heard from residents that they would like to get back to community-focused policing through an Esquimalt police. That could be a really expensive option and one that we cannot afford. I can tell you, though, if elected, the first council meeting I'm involved in, I will make a motion to make that police report, that advisory report, available to all of us so that we can make an informed decision going forward.
Thanks, Dave. And Tim Morrison.
If I could be so bold, I'll say I'll second that motion if I happen to be sitting beside Dave Hodgins at the council table. I'm going to be very straightforward with you. Number one question I get asked in hundreds and hundreds of doors I've been knocking on over the last several weeks is, do you support the RCMP plan? Let me be very straightforward. No, I do not. And the reason is because I don't have the information to make that decision. That's it. I've said that earlier. I won't say it again. I cannot support a plan that we as a community aren't allowed to know the details on. And I know that's why most of you are here tonight. Let's be straight about that. I think we get pretty good service from Vic PD. I'm actually a Block Watch co-captain. I was at my Block Watch meeting last night. Some of my members of my Block Watch are in my building are here tonight as well, and we get really good service from them. The problem is the cost. The cost is the issue. You look at Langford and Colwood. The combined populations of Langford and Colwood are twice that of Esquimalt. They pay less for their policing combined than we do. That's not right. So this is an opportunity. This is a great opportunity. We have the media on the side. Thank you to Dave Dixon and all his colleagues in the media. We have them on side. We have public opinion on our side. This is a great opportunity to seize what we've all wanted for so long, regional policing, efficient use of our tax dollars, and efficient fighting against crime. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Sandra Dixon.
I've heard all these answers, and I'm going, well, I agree. But here's my answer. The policing issue should be helped out by the bar owners paying into the police budget. They are the ones making more money, and that seems to be downtown seems to be where the problem is. Again, drug money found by the police should be shared with other communities to help out the cost. And I hate to say it, there's a lot of drugs out there. That way all the police stations can help out each other when needed, but also stay in their own communities. I myself would still like to see the Esquimalt have their own police just for safety reasons. Thank you.
Question number 6. This should be a good one. Sewage treatment seems to continue to be a high priority for the provincial government and CRD. Definitely one of my favorite questions. A number of respected oceanographers and medical experts state the current plan may do more harm than good. Federal and provincial governments both require proper communications and community involvement in large projects. CRD continues on with the project without incorporating this expert input and without meeting with Esquimalt and other communities. What will you do to help ensure the right sewage treatment plan is in place for Greater Victoria? We'll start with Linda Hundleby.
I believe that the science does not support land-based sewage treatment, nor the costs and greenhouse gases associated with its construction. That being said, the political agenda continues to request or mandate sewage treatment for the region, and no exemption has been asked to the federal government. Given that a federal exemption is not on the horizon, we have to maintain our lobbying of CRD. A socioeconomic review, triple bottom line, for the options has not been done, and Council, with my support, should continue to demand this, as well as the highest mitigation possible and amenity bonusing if facilities must be built near residential properties.
Josh Steffler.
I'm opposed to the sewage treatment plant. I don't think we need it. I've been to a few presentations where the oceanographers have said that what we're doing is fine. The problem is it is a public perception that we're dumping raw sewage into the ocean. We're not. And I'm worried about the CRD gathering more and more power over Esquimalt specifically, but as a region as a whole, we don't have to pay for sewage just because the province says so or the federal government says so. We can refuse and just not pay it. We don't want it. We don't need it. Why are we being forced to pay it? This is like $500 a year for each homeowner. What is that going to do for rent? Sustainable, low, affordable housing? Well, not if apartment buildings and rental buildings have to raise the cost for sewage treatment. Affordable visits to Esquimalt Recreation, not if we have to pay for the sewage treatment of Esquimalt Recreation. We have a chance to just tell them no and stand with the other municipalities that are saying, no, we're not paying for it, we're not going to pay for it, and you're not taking our money. We're just not doing it. There comes a time where you have to stand up and say no, and I will stand up, and I would gladly tell them, no, you're not getting my money. If you guys want to pay for it, that's one thing, but I will be holding my money back. My family can't afford it. And I know lots of other families can't afford it either. Thank you.
Megan Brame.
I have worked on this issue for longer than I've been on council, so this is one close to my heart. I do believe that the CRD is going down the wrong path. Whether you believe we need the sewage treatment plant or not, it's been mandated to us, but now we need to do it correctly. If we're going to have to do it, let's do it right. Let's make money on something rather than just lose money. The integrated resource management is the only way to go forward. And that way, our taxpayers are not going to be struggling. We are not going to be struggling to be paying $200-$300 plus a year just for sewage treatment on your taxes. We need to continue to be vocal and to work with the other communities that have the same thoughts and feelings on this as ourselves. We are not alone, but we need to keep talking about it and bringing the research forward. We cannot give up, but keep pushing forward. Major projects come with major price tags. Big projects such as sewage needs to be supported by all levels of government, not just by the taxpayer. Like Linda, I will be pushing for high mitigation and amenity bonusing if it goes through, but we need to make sure that they're going to do this the right way, not the wrong way.
Dave Schinbein.
Thank you. I am a 100% in supporting the status quo the way it is. I would definitely vote no to any huge, massive expense to change the current system. From what I've heard and from what I've read and from what I've talked to of people out there, they're saying exactly the same things. You're talking about a humongous bill to put this in place. And without wading too heavily into the science, I am pretty much convinced that the particular treatment system we're using right now does not pose an environmental issue that needs to be changed at this point in time. And I would not support that huge expenditure for the treatment plant. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
Sewage treatment in this area, the definition of frustration. Do you know that there has been no environmental study done on sewage treatment to suggest that treatment is even an issue? I mean, how can you go this far down the road, and this train has left the station, how can you go so far down the road and not have done an environmental impact study? So we talk about it's the wrong plan, but I think it's much more than simply being the wrong plan. I mean, we have evidence-based research by professionals that are saying, wait, stop, you're doing something that is maybe going to impact our environment in more of a negative way than a positive way. And certainly there are some things we need to do, you know, as source control, chemicals at source control, and things that make sense, but $1 billion. I mean, we can't afford to put money into something that is not going to make a positive impact. So what do we do? I mean, we talk about
The CRD's on side, other local governments are on side, the province is telling us, the federal government's telling us. Well, you know, I think it's time when we think about the sole gen is telling us what to do on policing. Well, we're saying no, that's not good enough. And on sewage treatment, we need to step up and we need to say stop, put the brakes on, this is not right, and you're not going to force it upon us. Thank you.
Tim Morrison.
I guess if there's one thing that all the candidates, and probably I'm guessing all the members of the audience, can agree on tonight, is that we need to take that CRD sewage plan and flush it down the toilet. Let's face it, folks. This is more about taxpayer waste than it is about sewage waste. But I think the I think the question said, what are we going to do? What are we going to do as potential councillors? Well, I'll tell you what I've been doing and what I would plan to do if I were a councillor. I would continue, I would start support for people in this audience, in fact, are here today, Karen James. Karen James is a volunteer member of the Esquimalt Residents Association who went out there and organized outside, in Esquimalt, but outside Esquimalt, got residents associations all over Greater Victoria better educated on this. This is not based on science. This is based on politics. She got them connected. She got them to a forum. She did that as a volunteer. Councillors, Esquimalt Council has to support that work. Volunteers can't do all the heavy lifting alone. Kim Bellefontaine is another member, another volunteer in our community. She has a different approach than Karen to sewage treatment, but the one thing they both agree on is the CRD plan is the wrong plan. We need a council that will support those grassroots members, not ignore them, but help them. Foster that opposition across the entire region. That's the only way we're going to defeat this. Thank you.
Sandra Dixon.
Hi. I'm probably the only person here that does not like computers. Computers don't like me. But I sat down at the computer one day and looked at sewer treatments in Hawaii. I looked at sewer treatments in New Zealand and Australia. And there was one more, but I forgot to write it down. Just to see what they did. I'm reading information people have sent me about other sewer systems. I need to know, I need to talk and listen more to more people to find out the costs, etc. I myself like the idea that condos have their own sewer treatment. Thank you.
Bob McKay.
Thank you. I think it's quite the subject to have
Did it get turned off?
No, it's down.
Are we here?
Yes.
We're here. Sewage. It's a great topic to have when you're the tourist capital of BC. Float into Victoria and look over the side. What are you going to see? Hopefully it's not those little brown things floating in the water. I have to agree with everybody that's up here. Sewage is a great big headache. The right sewage treatment plant in Greater Victoria will happen when the CRD listens to the people of Esquimalt and Victoria. We say there's no land big enough in our municipality to construct a sizable plant to handle the Greater Victoria sewage for now and in the future. We haven't got any room to expand for people to live here. How are we going to make a big enough piece of property that we can control our sewage? Also, we do not need toxic waste, sludge, being transported through our community with our children out there playing on the streets. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. Question number 7. Every morning and afternoon, our main roads in and out of Esquimalt are fairly locked up with delays due to West Shore crawl. Delays seem to be increasing. Transportation and safety topics within Esquimalt and across the CRD include bike lanes and paths, sidewalks, medians, lighting, LRT, and bus lanes. What do you see as the issues related to transportation in Esquimalt, and why? And we'll start with Josh Steffler.
Okay, so I've talked to a few people about transportation, and everybody has everybody I've talked to has a problem with the 3 p.m. traffic jam that you can't get anywhere. You can't go down Admiral's Road. You can't go down Esquimalt. I don't really know how to solve this. I think we have to ask everybody. There are some solutions that I think might work, but we could be using the ENN Railway in conjunction with the big shipbuilding contract that's going to be down at the shipyard. I live on Esquimalt Road by Admirals, and I see people driving by in one person, one car all day for that 3 p.m. rush. And if we were using buses or rail, light rail, on that transit line to get people in and out of Esquimalt rapidly and efficiently, I don't know if it would need to be we just allow some private contractor to come in and offer this service, or if we work with the base to differentiate times for people to get off, like maybe stagger them in half an hour blocks. I don't have the answer to the traffic solution. I would like to hear from you. I'm open to suggestions. And there's a few crosswalks that need some lighting and pedestrian-controlled lights. That's about it. Thanks.
Megan Brame?
Well, as many of you know, we have one of the largest employers in the region in our very own community, and then we have another large employer right next door. Currently, Esquimalt has reasonable connectivity to downtown via bikes, walking, and buses, but it's more the thoroughfare traffic that we have troubles with. We've worked hard this term to get the bus route from Jubilee Hospital, from Esquimalt to Jubilee. That's helped a little. We also continue to lobby the late night bus service from downtown and have managed to keep it in service for 2 years, even though they've threatened it every year to cut it down. So we're keeping it going. What we are, however, still lacking is the more frequent and direct route to the West Shore. The ENN rail line is a perfect opportunity to use that. We've tried really hard to do a trial run, but then the rail line got shut down. Our congestion on our roads needs to be a top priority, not just for Esquimalt, but the entire region. It is not just an Esquimalt problem, it is everyone's problem. I have to say that the rapid buses that BC Transit has is not really going to work in the current condition of our roads. It's not really an option for a variety of reasons. There's too many cars on the road, not enough space. And right now, a lot of the transit studies and transit lines that they've got going in their new plans is to go outside of Esquimalt, having connecting lines, not connecting directly into Esquimalt. So as a councillor, I will continue to lobby for frequent transit into our community, not beside it.
Dave Schinbein.
Transportation, this is another area that does require long-term planning. And transportation and development are linked. And I think a lot of times when we bring in development to an area, we're not looking at, especially if it's got density, in a place that, for example, where they build something that where there was three houses there, now there's a larger facility there, so instead of six people living in between that area, there's now 200. Those type of issues need to be looked at when we're deciding on our transportation. I am abundantly in favor of reviewing a lot of our streets and roads around here, specifically with looking at the idea of ensuring that every street has a sidewalk on it. That every street, you know, and where proper crosswalks are needed. All of those things facilitate the movement of people. And I do agree also that the general overall transportation needs of this area needs to be a regional issue. It has been said that we can do what we want in the Esquimalt, but the roads all connect to somebody else. So, and I guess my pet peeve would be to see that the BC Transit bus routes accommodate people that do shift work. If you start your shift at 7 o'clock downtown, does you no good if the bus on Saturday only starts running at 7. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
Well, certainly there's an identified need for enhanced transportation systems within the greater area. As I talk to individuals about how they go about using the transit system, there's an awful lot of frustration. And because the system is so hard to connect with and use, people then shy away from using it. And when people don't use the system, you don't have the resources and the user base to grow the system to make it more effective for the people to use. So you can see it's a real catch-22. And until we actually get to a place where we've done the right planning and involved the users, the people that actually ride the buses, make use of the roadways, etc., and that's light rapid transit as well. I mean, we can't simply sit back in an office somewhere in a government building and design a system and say, well, here it is, live with it. I mean, we have to really be inclusive and engage and involve people in to come up with the right solutions. So at the same time, I hear from people that I've met as I've been out door knocking that there's a real need to enhance and add additional crosswalks within our community, and certainly a need to pay attention to school safety zones and do much more to provide for the safety of our children. I think to get at this and to do the right job really requires the one government approach. We need to reach out across the area and better connect to do the right thing.
Thanks, Dave. Tim Morrison.
Yeah, I also live pretty much outside of CFB Esquimalt, so I know exactly what it's like. I'm usually at work at 3 o'clock, so I don't experience that portion of it, but I do hear the traffic. I don't need an alarm clock because I hear all the traffic going in there quite early in the morning. It is a huge amount of congestion in a very concentrated period of time. But I wanted to sort of, I think we've covered the issue of cars and the roads and whatnot, but I want to talk about pedestrian safety. That's a big part of transportation as well, especially locally here in the community. And I want to pay a little tribute to yet another Esquimalt resident. Kelly Bryant is here in the audience. Kelly invited me to come down. His house is right across the street from Macaulay School. And he invited me to come down and check for myself how dangerous it is for children getting out of school at Macaulay because of people speeding on Lyle Street. Military vehicles, BC Transit buses, local Esquimalt residents, people coming into our community, they're all speeding at Lyle Street as kids are coming out. And we need to be aware of that. You know, council needs to be informing the community a little better about public safety. And most of all, we need to not ignore people like Kelly Bryant who come forward saying, I've documented this, I'm concerned. It's just a matter of time before a child is hurt or even worse. We need to be proactive on that. We need to be working in the community to make our streets safer for pedestrians. One more thing on the LRT, I'm against it because I'm concerned that we're going to end up paying $1 billion for something. In order to pay for it, we're going to lose our bus service in Esquimalt. And we've already heard from David
Anderson
that that's a problem.
Thanks. Sandra Dixon.
Okay. We need better and safer bike lanes and pathways for those that use them. The bike lane that has just been put down by the E&N rail line is not safe. The fence should have more designated openings. It is because students and other people are now climbing over the fence. And I can see kids throwing over their bikes, getting to the schools and going through the back way. I talk to kids about car safety and road safety, and that's why I see them walking on the railroad tracks. And I can see just right now that they're going to be throwing their bikes over the fence that's there. If there is a designated crossing, the train conductor would know where the people would be crossing. To help the West Shore crawl, we need more double-decker buses in peak times. Talk to the bus drivers about the peak times. Also, someone on TV said, use the ocean. People, a walk-on ferry, why not from Colwood to downtown? It's a good idea. If the federal government is thinking of selling land. Use that land.
Thanks, Sandra.
Thank you.
Bob McKay.
The issues related to transportation in Esquimalt, as I say, I've been in Esquimalt for 40-some-odd years, and it, as far as I am concerned, was changed when Esquimalt Road went from two lanes to one lane with little gardens in the middle. This was said to control the main flow of traffic in and out of Esquimalt. It's already been stated we have the largest employer. My concern is what happens between 3 and 5 o'clock at night when both lanes are jammed up, coming and going into and out of Esquimalt, and all of a sudden we have a major catastrophe. Where's our fire trucks go? Can't get down Esquimalt Road because we got a flower garden in the middle. Sorry, folks. I enjoy gardens, but I don't think they need them in the front of the streets. Since we put those in, I've heard nothing but complaints from Lyle Street and Old Esquimalt Road. They're the main thoroughfares now. How do you get in and out of Esquimalt at 50 to 60 Ks? Go down Lyle Street, go down Old Esquimalt Road. I think we need to get back to the two lanes on Esquimalt Road, and that will get our traffic back to a normal flow. Thank you.
And Linda Hundleby.
We have this West Shore crawl that begins on Admirals Road. I'd really like to see the ENN rail service for freight and passenger commutes. We lack bike lanes along Admirals Road, and maybe that would help the north-south link. We need rail crossings along the ENN rail trail so that they can be completed so that people can use them. We have speeding and we have traffic calming measures. And related to this, we have requests for traffic calming speed humps. And in the same breath, we want smoothly paved streets. Street cleaning. Oh, I should mention, with the traffic calming measures, I don't think we've had any fatalities since, so maybe it might not be a bad thing. Street cleaning. There's debris on the bike lanes, and I know I've heard complaints about that. The parking issues. They're most contentious when concerning new developments and also for residential side streets. We need accessible sidewalks and curbs. The Access Awareness Advisory Committee continues to request these on behalf of those using walkers, wheelchairs, scooters, baby carriages, and strollers, and for those of us with arthritic hips and knees. The bus transportation early morning and late night, this is done, was done on a trial basis. We really need to keep that up. I think it does is a great service for us. And in terms of regional, the transit authority should be regional, not provincial. Thank you.
Thank you. Time for our final question of the evening. Students at Esquimalt High Schools, their issues include bike lanes, LRT, housing, and the street population. Others in our community have expressed concerns regarding safer streets, absentee landlords, and property maintenance, and need for more recreational facilities. Where are your priorities for a safer, healthier, more vibrant Esquimalt community? And we'll start with Megan Brame.
My priorities for a safer Esquimalt is to move forward with policing and getting the situation finalized and finding a police force that will meet our community needs. For a healthy community, I want to continue to work with staff and residents to make sure that our parks and recreation facilities are top-notch and continue to be the best in the region. The more people participate in physical activity, the better they feel. We need to make sure that there are housing options to meet all of the needs of our residents of all ages, young and retired. For a vibrant and fabulous community, I will continue to work to promote more businesses coming to our community. I will continue to support our strong community spirit through the various community events that we have in Esquimalt, and next year in our centennial, there will be lots. Community spirit helps create engagement within the community, and the more engaged people are, the more connected they feel, and therefore the stronger we are socially and economically as a community.
Dave Schinbein.
Thank you. My priorities.
Use the mic.
Oh, I'm sorry. My priorities for a safer Esquimalt and just the priorities in general. I do believe that one of the big priorities that we have to work on as a municipality is to come to an agreement on a vision for the community. We have to get together as a group and decide which vision do we really want for this municipality. I also believe that the priority also has to be accountability. And the accountability, of course, factors into everything that we do. It factors into all the different types of residents here, all the different types of social issues that there might be. And there has to be a level of accountability. We have to also acknowledge that people are responsible for their actions, and that as a municipality, we can't always be the nanny state to come in and solve certain problems. We also need to make sure that information is readily available to all our residents, that for the various issues and problems that come up, that when solutions are being talked about, the information is there, it's transparent, it's there for everybody to see. We also need to look at our current infrastructure and make sure that it's maintained, and it's maintained in a safe state. And finally, that the overall environment within Esquimalt is a safe and pleasant experience for everyone. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
The three priorities that I would address are based on, again, what I've been told as I meet with individuals and groups, and there's some real strong messaging happening, and I thank you for that. The first one is about open, honest, and transparent governance, and so that council is doing business in such a way as to be inclusive and to engage individuals. It's difficult to address a lot of the other challenges around the safety within the community with health issues and recreation issues and other community services in the absence of that ability to be open and communicative with all the user groups and the citizens. And I really believe that that openness needs to extend beyond council into administration. I think there's a real opportunity for our administration to be much more open and available to the citizens that we all seek to serve. The second one is around the safety issues. And the safety issues also connects back to the wellness issues, because if people aren't safe and secure within their communities, they're not going to reach out and make use of the good services that we have available, the recreational services, for example. So it's time in this regard that we actually put public safety ahead of politics and get that in the right order. And the next priority being a growth and development done in an open, transparent, planned, and respectful way. And so there's much more that needs to be said around those, but that's a high overview of
Thanks,
the
Dave.
Issues.
Tim Morrison.
A few words. No more money marts. No more money lending stores. We know we're much better than that. We know that. We love this community. We know all the greatness that happens in this community. People from outside Esquimalt have a negative view of us because they drive along Esquimalt Road and all they see is money lending stores. And let's face it, I was at a council meeting not too long ago. Guess what business came forward as the newest business to get a business license in Esquimalt? Another money mart. Guess where it's going to be? Right next to our prized Archie Browning Center, where children, where youth, where families go. You know, that's not a vibrant future for Esquimalt. And as I mentioned earlier, I did work as one of my government projects in my extensive background in policy and communications. In the community charter. There are sections of the community charter that allow for revitalization. We need to explore that. I also think, you know, we have a lot of committees in Esquimalt, a lot of advisory committees that work with the council, but we don't have a public safety awareness committee. And if a new council is going to be revamping our governance structure, I think we need to look at appointing people like yourself to a public awareness safety committee that will include the students here from Esquimalt High, will include our police personnel, will include our fire personnel, and just work together to design a community that's much more inviting and safe and vibrant and attracting newer, more positive businesses for our community. Thank you very much.
Sandra Dixon.
Okay, for safety, we need better, better policing, safer bike lanes, and having the lights stay on longer so people can get across the street. Health-wise, you students won't like me on this one. Students should get involved indoors and outdoors activities. Bring back PE for all grades. Get schools to challenge other schools in fitness programs. Bring in people to talk to students about overeating and other health issues. Get students to talk amongst themselves in classes. That's what I wish they did when I was in school. Businesses should clean up their garbage all around their business. Landlords should be around more or called if there is a problem. If someone complains about a building like we did, the problem being with drugs, don't let it take 6 months or more to fix the problem. The police said their hands were tied. The landlord did not have any complaints because he was getting his money. No one told us where to go or what to do, and we didn't know what else to do.
Thanks, Sandra.
Thank you.
Bob McKay.
My priorities for safer, healthier community is number one, let's get our policing situation squared off so we know that we are safe 24/7. Healthier community is completed when we showcase our facilities to everyone, not just to Esquimalt, to Greater Victoria, and ensure there is a fair and equitable way that we can be used by everyone. Housing is another main issue. Our main concern is we cannot expand out, so we have to expand up. So we have to do that with limited vision. That's what's happening now, and I think the people of Esquimalt need to have more of a voice in the expansion. Vision for Esquimalt by talking to the students, retirees, and family members of what they would like to see in Esquimalt, what they use in Esquimalt, so that we can critique those facilities to match what the people want, not what we think they want. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
For me, the police services need to be finalized. That means working with the Solicitor General and our future service provider. We need to repair and maintain our infrastructure, including our sewers. We need to update our storm drains and to make our sidewalks accessible. We need cultural and recreational opportunities for all ages. That represents a community investment, which I support. We need a promotion for health and fitness, a sense of community that is caring, community spirit, and economic development. We need to develop ways to determine the types of programs that residents and families would like and which would provide the best value. We need a long-range community vision that would assist in determining direction, funding, and planning for infrastructure, amenities, and developments. Together, we can make it work. Thank you.
And Josh Steffler.
My priorities for a safer, healthier, and more vibrant Esquimalt community would really boil down to having council protect people's property rights. For safety reasons, you know, if Esquimalt Council is protecting our property rights, we won't have the CRD transporting toxic sewage through our communities. If we've got our municipality protecting our property rights from the CRD again, we have more money in our pockets to live healthier lifestyles, to choose to go to the rec center, to buy that new bike instead of having to pay that new bike money to the CRD for sewage treatment or for LRT. And again, with property rights, we are able to create a more vibrant community by allowing the property owners to build businesses or houses that don't impinge on other people's rights, but are allowed the freedom to be creative and come up with innovative and new ideas that aren't just dictated to where, I kind of lost my train of thought, but where we're respecting other people's property rights, they will get to respect ours. And I think that if the Esquimalt Municipal Council is respecting, enforcing, and encouraging property rights with everybody, it will be a more vibrant, more safe, and more healthy city, municipality, and we could be an example for the rest of the communities around us. Thank you.
Thanks, Josh. That concludes the question portion of tonight's candidate meeting. Now, there you go. Thanks, candidates. Now it's time for the final remarks. Each candidate will have 1 minute for their final remarks, and we'll start at the beginning here with Dave Schinbein.
Thank you, and I'd like to especially thank everybody for showing up tonight. Your interest in public affairs is very heartwarming. It shows that should I become one of your counselors, I know that I'm going to hear from you, and I know that you're going to be vocal, and I know that you're going to be getting your message across so that I can convey that message to the rest of council and use that strong support that you could give me as your counselor to help accomplish the things that need to be done. Again, I would like to solicit your support on November the 19th. I feel that my previous experience as a municipal counselor will help with the deliberations at council and maybe bring some uniqueness to it and some fresh new ideas that perhaps haven't been done before. Again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming out, and I look forward to your support. Thank you.
Dave Hodgins.
What a great opportunity to share, if only briefly, you know, what I've heard and some of what I believe in with respect to the significant issues and challenges that we have ahead of us. And, you know, really of interest to me in all of this is to make sure that we put the interests of the residents of Esquimalt ahead of politics. We need to get to a place where we are truly operating on the democracy that was structured so that the people are influencing the system in the right way, and politics is there to support what the residents of Esquimalt are saying needs to happen. I'd like to thank the Chamber and the Esquimalt Residents Association, the students for organizing this great event, and especially I would like to thank my campaign manager and the love of my life, Catherine, and she's doing a great job of keeping me organized.
I've got her vote.
And just to wrap up, I would also really appreciate it if you would consider voting for Hodgins on November 19th or in one of the advanced polls. And when you look for Dave, make sure you get the right Dave on the list. I'm number 3 on the list. That's Dave Hodgins.
Thanks, Dave. Tim Morrison.
Well, there's only one Tim running, so you can just vote for Tim. And if you forget my name, if you can't remember Tim, then you probably remember Jim Morrison, obviously the dead rock star. So just remember Tim Morrison. It's not difficult, right? So as you take a look, you know, one thing that jumps out to you in the audience is probably that obviously we're going to have the next council, the majority of our next council will be new. And with a new council, we need to have councillors who are going to be effective from the get-go. One of the things that I have done for the last 2 years is sat in the gallery of Esquimalt Chamber, Municipal Chambers. The current councillors know me quite well as a familiar face. As co-chair of the Esquimalt Residents Association and as editor of the EsquimaltReview.com, I have that proven track record of commitment and connection to the community, informing the community, listening very carefully to the issues, making sure that the message gets out to everybody. Do you know what's going on? Do you know what council's doing? You know, you should have your say on that. And that's the kind of approach I will take as councillor as well, is to be open, accessible, to be listening to you, and to be acting on your desires for the future of our Esquimalt. Thank you very much. Vote Tim Morrison. Just remember the Doors, Jim Morrison, Tim Morrison.
Thanks, Tim.
Not difficult to remember. Thanks. Thank you very much. And thank you so much to everyone that organized this. I know it was all volunteer-driven, too.
Sandra Dixon.
Hi. I don't know what to say. I didn't think of a speech.
but I'm glad to be here. I'm glad the people that I talked to talked me into doing this and said, hey, you can do it. I'll try my best. I've never done this before. I'm not good on computers. Actually, my son has helped me type things out. My husband has edited things. And so if I get voted in, I'll buy new equipment for my computer. And I swear I will try to do my best instead of throwing it out of the window. And that's all I can say. I'll try my best, and that's good enough, I think. Thank you.
Thanks, Sandra. Bob McKay?
There's only one Bob on the ballot. And this time he's lucky he's number one on the ballot. But all I can say is thank you to everybody for coming out. I think those people that know me know that when I take on something, I will give it 110%. This is a new structure for me. I've been slowly climbing the ladder, and a number of people have said, well, step forward and let's see what you can do. Well, I'm offering myself forward to be one of your counselors, and I will give you 110%. I'm 150% behind Esquimalt because I have lived in here, I've raised my kids, I have grandkids that live in this area, so I'm not going anywhere anytime soon. Thank you.
Linda Hundleby.
Thank you. I urge and encourage everyone who is 18 years of age and older and who's eligible to vote, please go and vote at the polling station at the Municipal Hall, 1229 Esquimalt Road, on November the 16th or November the 19th from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. You have my brochure, my email address, my telephone number. I have a website. I am on Facebook. Thank you for coming tonight. Thank you to the organizers. I'm number 5 on your ballot. I'm Linda Hundleby. Thank you.
Josh Steffler.
I would encourage all of you to vote for me, obviously. I think that Esquimalt is one of the best communities in Canada. I've been coast to coast, and really the only ones that compare are in Prince Edward Island, another island. I would, as a councillor, stand against the ever-encroaching reach that the CRD is reaching into Esquimalt to govern us, to take our tax dollars, your hard-earned dollars. We are facing massive tax increases, and we need to have people that aren't going to say, well, the CRD has jurisdiction. Well, the Solicitor General says so, so it must be so. You cannot govern without consent of the governed, and the CRD is governing without consent of myself, at least, and I hear a lot of other people. I don't want a sewage treatment plant. I don't think we can afford it. I don't want the billion-dollar LRT thing. I don't think we can afford it. So I would encourage you to vote for me if you believe in more self-governance and property rights and lower taxes. You know, we need to have a freeze on tax increases and have us live within our means, both in our city hall and everything else. Thank you.
And Megan Brame.
I'm very proud of the work that I have done, along with the rest of the current council, over the past 3 years, but we have much more to do. Esquimalt is in the midst of some major changes, and I want to be a part of that. I want to be your voice on council. I have worked hard for this community, and I believe that my experience and dedication will serve you and the community as a whole well during these times of exciting change. I hope that on November 19th, I can count on your support to continue working for you as an Esquimalt councillor. Megan Brame is number 4 on the ballot.
Thank you, candidates. Right now, I'd like to welcome back up to the podium with some closing remarks, Mayor Barb Desjardins.
Thank you all. Thank you, candidates. It's going to be interesting. and I welcome it. I want to just take a couple of minutes to talk to you about what I stand for. Because although you don't have a choice now, I'm also one of these people. You have given me a mandate to continue. In the next term, I want to continue to move forward with the Esquimalt Village Corps project. Over the past 5 years, we have received and continue to seek public input for developing and refining that concept plan for the Old Town Hall and public works sites. The community and the Advisory Planning Commission have shown general support for this process and plan. This is important to Esquimalt and our future. I want to complete the Esquimalt Policing Request for Proposal process, as proposed by the Esquimalt Police Advisory Panel and approved unanimously by your council. This, too, has been a very long process, starting in 2008 with the request for the Vic PD audit, and it was to ask and have an audit done with respect to the service delivery that we wanted to have, and were we getting it? The funding model that is currently unsustainable for Esquimalt, and the governance model, being able to have a say in how much, when, where, how, and how we as a community participate. We have not yet completed this process. We are working with the province to provide all information required for the Solicitor General's approval. There will be significant public input and involvement in the process as we go forward. There is no finality at this time. I will continue to advocate for a better sewage treatment solution for the region. CRD has been very quiet, if you have noticed. Those of you that follow the Core Liquid Waste Management meetings know that there haven't been many, and they sure as heck haven't had much to talk about. I anticipate that's going to change in the new year. The current plan of McLaughlin Point and Heartland landfill sites is the wrong plan. Finally, I want to continue to develop and implement tax policies that will facilitate economic growth and reduce municipal tax burdens. I want you to vote on the 16th or the 19th of November, this month. It is your responsibility to participate. I have heard many people say, I'm not going to vote. That is not going to help. We need to hear from you, and this is your opportunity, your first opportunity to say who you want to represent you. Our doors are always open. Mine is always open. You can call me. You can find me in many places. I'm very accessible, and I will continue to be. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you to the people that put this on and the volunteers. Thank you, Dave. And good luck to the candidates.
Thanks, Barb. I should also mention that the proceedings tonight have been videotaped, and they will be uploaded to a YouTube under Modern Democracy. So ensure that you tell your neighbors, your friends and your family to take a look at it if they couldn't get a chance tonight, because this is a good opportunity to find out what issues the candidates stand on. And also, I should mention, another opportunity to chat and meet the candidates is coming up this Sunday, November the 13th, at the Esquimalt Serious Coffee. It's a chance to meet the Esquimalt Town Council, or future council, I should say. So that's coming up this weekend on Sunday and at 2 o'clock at Serious Coffee in Esquimalt. Once again, I'd like to thank the Esquimalt Residents Association and the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce for organizing tonight's event, all the hard work by the volunteers, thanks to the candidates, thanks to you for coming out and listening to what they have to say. I think it is important, and you're going to have a chance here in a few minutes to ask some more questions of the candidates. They're going to be in the foyer for the next several minutes. And of course, can't stress it enough, November 16th and of course November 19th, get out and vote. It's your duty, I feel. So get out there and vote. Thanks again. Dino Fioran, the Esquimalt Chamber of Commerce President, with a few words as well. Thank you.
Dave must have read my speech. Anyway, one thing that I would like you all to do is stay put until the candidates get out into the lobby so you'll have an opportunity to talk to them. Because if you start out now, they'll never get off the stage. So if you could hang tough for a couple of minutes. Now, our candidates have all been talking about public input. One of the ways we can have public input is each one of us grab a friend and go to the polling booth, because they can sit here and they can talk. But if we don't vote for whoever we think did the best talk, then we have nobody to complain to but ourselves. Just have a good look in the mirror, say get out and vote, and do what you should do. The other thing is, I'm really proud of the students of this school. I had three children come through this school over the years, but that's going back into ancient history. But we did have some modern facilities in those days too. On behalf of all the sponsors, I would like to thank each and every one of you for coming out tonight. Dave, wherever you're hiding behind the curtain, you did an excellent job, and thank you very, very much. Now, I see a little note here. We will be posting answers from the candidates tomorrow if you would like to follow up. We will have a link at www.esquimaltchamber.ca to get the information. Also, I think it's been mentioned that the candidates will be at the Serious Coffee in the Esquimalt Plaza between 2 and 4 on Sunday. So if you have questions or you want to tell them what you think, that's a good time to get together with them. And I thank you, each and every one, for coming out, the candidates, our mayor, and all the hard work. The chamber didn't do that much. We did a little bit of work, but the Esquimalt Residents Association deserve a great applause for a job well done. Thank you.
You guys get off the stage and get up there so the rest of us can come up there and give you hell. Thank you.